You're listening to the Vibrant Happy Women podcast, episode number 105. My guest today is Gina Brodtmann, who will be telling us how she let go of perfectionism and fear and chose to embrace vulnerability, which made her way more confident. You're going to love this episode. Stay tuned.
Welcome to the Vibrant Happy Women podcast, stories of vibrant women living happy lives. And now your host, Jen Riday.
Hey, welcome back to the Vibrant Happy Women podcast. I'm Jen Riday, mom of six. I know, crazy town, and I feel it sometimes. But I am here to help each of you listening to shift from a place of burnout and overwhelm into being your most vibrant and happy self. That's what this podcast is all about. Welcome to the show. So today is your last chance to enter to win a $100 gift card from Amazon. And we're doing that to celebrate 100 episodes, which we hit a few weeks back. To enter, simply go to jenriday.com/giveaway. We'll announce our winners on Thursday. So I love our call-in line, and I'm grateful for my trusty friend, Sarah Bates, who continues to call in, and she has good thoughts. Everyone take a page from Sarah's book. Add our call-in number to your phone. I'll tell you one more time what that is. If you're driving, you can pull over right now and hit pause and add this. It is 608-352-6586. I want to hear from you. Anyway, I want to share with you Sarah's latest message. Sarah said the following.
Hi, Jen. It's Sarah Bates. I was literally just feeling down in the dumps this morning about some text messages I received from a family member asking me yet again, what could they buy for my children for an upcoming holiday? And I literally said aloud, I am so tired of consumption. I'm so tired of this. I'm so tired of just having things come into my home. I want to start creating and putting things out of my home and not being a consumer, being a creator. And wouldn't you know that as I was putting fresh sheets on my bed and listening to your podcast, the exact discussion you were having with your guest. So I just wanted to tell you once again, love the show, love your guests. They always hit home for me. And sometimes I feel like they are actually inside my head. So thanks, Jen. Keep up the great work. Keep inspiring us.
Sarah, that's an interesting comment you left. I actually get that exact comment a lot of times. People say all the time, I was just thinking about something and then I turned on the podcast and the guest was talking about it. I don't know what kind of woo-woo magic is going on in the universe, but I'm glad it's resonating for you guys. So that episode that Sarah's referring to is our last episode with Joanna Penn when she talked about being creative. What are we putting out into the universe rather than consuming? So inspiring. Lots of you loved that and wrote in about that. So thank you for your comments. And you're going to love today's guest as well, Gina Brodtmann. She was at the Vibrant Happy Women retreat with me in February, and I just loved her story, and I knew I had to have her share it. She is talking about how she is choosing to let go of perfectionism, which has held her back for years, and making the choice to be vulnerable and authentic. So let's go ahead and dive in and hear what Gina has to teach us. My guest today is Gina Brodtmann, and she lives in St. Paul, Minnesota. She's married with two teenage stepsons and an almost two-year-old little boy. She works as an accountant for a law firm, and while she has a knack for details, her current passion is child development. Gina's been on a lifelong journey of personal growth and self-development. She loves to learn and grow, and though she struggles with fear and perfectionism, she's been working on pushing through those fears and letting go of control, which she feels has led to so much more happiness and authentic connections. Gina, I love your bio, and I can't wait to chat. Welcome to Vibrant Happy Women.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm excited to be here.
So, Gina, we're going to start off with a quote, but first maybe we should talk about that you're a big Vibrant Happy Women fan. How many episodes have you listened to?
Oh, all of them. Every single one. A couple of them more than one.
So I'll actually admit I'm more intimidated to interview you than almost any guest because you know the show so well. So it's different for
me. Well, that's funny. Yeah, I love you. I love the show. I love everything about it. So yeah, don't be intimidated. I'm such a fan, and I just love this process so much. In fact, we went on a little family retreat last summer to like a group of cabins with my side of the family. So my parents and my sister and my brother and everybody's kids. Mm-hmm. And I actually did your questions with them and loved it. It was so fun. I was just so inspired by the things that you ask all your guests. And it was just an amazing way to connect as a family. And we all learned so much about each other. And
That's so great. I might have to try that. I've never done it with my actual people in my life.
Yeah.
That'll be good. Maybe I'll ask my own kids. That would be interesting. Yeah. Cool. Yeah. Well, thanks for the idea. Well, let's jump in and have your favorite quote, and then we'll learn more about you, because I already know you kind of from the Vibrant Happy Women Retreat, and I think you're amazing. So what quote would you want to share today?
Sure. So my quote is from Magda Gerber, who is a child development sort of pioneer who really came up with a really wonderful philosophy of how to see children and really how to see people. And so this is a quote that I have sitting at my desk at work. It goes, "There is dignity in struggle. It gives the soul muscle."
Ooh.
Yeah.
Wow. So tell us more about, let's go right into your struggles so we can hear how you've developed muscle. Because a lot of times women say, oh, I'm struggling, my life sucks. But you're saying we struggle, and that's a good thing because we're getting strong. So I can't wait to hear what that looks like for you.
Yeah, I think this just fits so well with the subject of perfectionism and fear and just life. And I know that for me, it was such an aha moment when I, for the first time, heard or kind of came across the idea of allowing the struggle, going through the struggle, rather than as a perfectionist trying to avoid the struggle, which is what I'd been doing my whole life, doing everything I can to either prepare ahead of time to be perfect so that I wouldn't feel any pain or wouldn't have any fear or wouldn't come across anything challenging, and or just avoiding anything challenging in the first place so that I wouldn't feel those uncomfortable feelings. And so this came across when I was learning about child development. I took a workshop last summer, and with infants and toddlers, which is what her work is really surrounding, they're saying that's how they're going to learn, how they're going to grow, is when we as their parents allow them to struggle through. So if you swoop in and save your baby who's, you know, trying to stand up for the first time and you never allow that fall, they're not really going to learn it. You're actually preventing growth when you try to prevent struggle. And so I just kind of had this huge epiphany about myself with all of that, where I really saw in myself this pattern in my past of, you know, doing everything I could, kind of like I said, to avoid struggling. And I really saw that, okay, I have to go through the struggle. I can't go around the fear. I can't go around the scary feelings that something new is going to bring up. I have to go through them. And when I go through them, it's always worth it. You know, I think there's another quote that I'm pretty sure one of your guests said at some time, or maybe you said it on some video call or something, that everything awesome is on the other side of fear.
Ooh, and I like that.
Yeah, I love that too. And I really, it's like I intellectually knew that before, but I wasn't living it and I wasn't really pushing myself to be brave and go through struggle. And so to kind of go a little bit more into my story and my low point, which I know you ask a lot of guests about a year and a half ago, my stepson had struggled with drugs and we ended up having to put him into a drug treatment program. And that was at just a few months after my baby had been born. So we had this new baby. We're not sleeping. We're so stressed about the drugs and our son going down a really scary path. And I think that I had to figure out a better way to deal with it, because my husband and I were just really, we weren't handling it well. My tendency when I get scared is to go into this control place where I just want to start blaming and controlling and, you know, being really black and white. And then he goes into this, when he's afraid, he goes into kind of the opposite, where he just kind of doesn't function, doesn't want to deal with it, wants to shut down and just hope it'll get taken care of. And then, so as you can imagine, the more one of us would do our thing, the other one would go even further into their thing. And so we were just so far apart. We're having this, you know, everybody acknowledges that a new baby is stressful and a child going through drug treatment is stressful. And so having them both at the same time and then having us handle it so differently, we were just going further and further apart. And I guess I just knew I'm trying to control everything and it's making it worse. And I think it all kind of came along at the same time of this epiphany of saying, we have to just go through this struggle. We can't, you know, I can't use my perfectionism to do this really clean, awesome job of just handling it. And, you know, we're going to have to let it be messy. I'm going to have to be super imperfect. I'm going to have to ask for help, which perfectionists hate doing, mm-hmm. and really be vulnerable, really, you know, check my side of myself that wants to blame or be judgmental and just find that compassion and go through and sit in this really uncomfortable, uncertain time where we didn't know how it was going to go. You know, it wasn't going well at first when we sent him in and we had to really just let that play out. And it was really hard. It was really hard.
So you sent him to a drug treatment program when you said sent him in? Is mm-hmm. that what you mean? Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what does that even look like? Go through it. I'm trying to get it into words or into something visceral. Do you just say, I'm going to feel this uncertainty and be okay with it?
A little bit. Yeah. I think that for me anyway, the need for certainty, it really leads me down the wrong path almost every time because there's desperation to it. And so because I can be black and white, I want to go one way or the other. Like, I'm going to control everything. I'm going to tell everybody what they need to say and what they need to do. And here's the list of everything that has to happen. Or I'll go down the other path, which is to say, screw it. All right, fine. I'm not going to do anything then because nobody's helping. Right. Nobody's listening. And I start getting really judgmental, really blaming. And so I have to somehow sit in between those two things, which is so hard. And I have to keep my heart open and say, okay, everybody is doing the best they can in a really scary situation. I have to keep doing my best and try not to focus on comparing it to what other people are doing. And then, yeah, sit in the uncertainty and just say, this isn't going to get resolved. Like, I'm the kind of person that if I have a fight with my husband, like, I want to resolve it tonight. We'll stay up till 2 a.m. if we have to do it. And that's just not healthy. You need to give things space and time. And we needed to let so much sink in and stew, both with us and with our son and the therapist we were working with, you know, to let everybody process everything that was happening. And yeah, so giving things time and trusting that I don't have an answer right now and it's just not ready to come yet, but it's okay. And somehow still having a good day, being there for my little baby, you know, getting my work done. And I just was like forced. I had this moment, I can remember it so clearly, of like, I can either be miserable every second of every day or I'm going to have to find a way to be okay in this gray area that really makes me want to squirm. But
yeah,
I had to live it. And then that's where all the answers came, of course.
Ah.
None of the answers came from the black or the white. They all came from the gray area where it was a combination of myself and my husband and our family members and therapists and figuring out, you know, just the right mix of what we were going to do about each aspect of it.
Ooh, yeah. So you couldn't control it, but
no.
The gray was everyone's input. Everyone throwing in some ingredients, mixing it up, letting it simmer for a while.
Yeah.
And seeing what you could create together.
Yeah.
Well, I want to go back to two things you talked about. You mentioned that you had to do your best not to compare to what everyone else is doing. So first of all, I want to say I see myself in what you're saying so much. Mm-hmm. And so one thing I do right now is compare my teens to other teens. And my teens tend to be more headstrong and independent, and they don't want those rules and they bristle against them. And when I get stuck in comparison, then I'll try to control and clamp down and they react and it just doesn't work. I'm trying to be black and white. And so where do you think that need to compare came from and how did that feel to let go of that?
That's such a good question. Where it came from, I think it just comes from
life,
from being a perfectionist. And I don't know where all that exactly comes from. I mean, I'm a firstborn, which I...
Me too.
Are you? Yeah. That doesn't surprise me. Yeah, I think that we just have this sense of responsibility and just seeing all there is to see and knowing what needs to be done. And when you see everything that needs to be seen, you can see what to compare everything to. And so, you know, we're partially in the future all the time, you know, looking ahead of what do we need to prepare for. And so, yeah, I guess it just comes from from that and from a feeling of not wanting to be vulnerable. I think when you, I don't want to let anyone see the messy side or what I'm not doing well, or yeah, with your kids, you want everyone to just see the best of them. And yet the reality is all of our kids go through struggles and have their flaws and their strengths. And so, yeah, I think then to say, how did I learn to let go of comparison? Again, I really think that this parenting workshop that I took was so amazing because it was kind of along those same lines of saying, we can't look at our children as these extensions of what we want them to be or what society is trying to make everybody be or whatever. We are all these unique beings that are just, you know, full of our own unique potential and possibility. And you can't find this one cookie cutter answer of how you're supposed to be a good parent and how you're supposed to be a good wife or whatever. It's, you have to look at that child that you're dealing with, that individual child, and say, how can I be the best parent to you? Or how can I be the best wife to my particular husband who has his own fears and insecurities? Mm-hmm. And so I think once I realized, what's the point of comparing to everybody else when everybody else doesn't have the exact same set of circumstances that we have? Yes. We're all in our own unique situation.
Yes.
Yeah.
So how did you let go of the idea that people might be judging you, even if you weren't comparing anymore? How'd you let go of that fear? Because it's very real.
Yeah, that's something I struggle with still. It's really hard, you know, doing what is best for me or my family, despite what other people think, is kind of one of my big life journey lessons. And I don't know how exactly I do it, except that I imagine almost like tuning out the world. And I just imagine this like little bubble around us. And I say, I can't control what happens outside of here, but in this little bubble here, I'm going to look you in the eyes. And I just, all I know is that is what's right for us right now. And nobody else understands it. And maybe that's part of it too, is that, you know, nobody who hasn't been through it can really understand what it's like to have a child go through drug treatment and all that leads up to it. And it's so easy to be judgmental, I'm sure, from the outside and say, well, you just needed to have better rules. And why weren't you, why didn't you have them under control? And it's like, you have no idea what led up to that and how much went into that and just some of the other factors. And so I think the more that I was able to, like I said before, I can tend to be that judgmental person because you think if you judge that person, then I'm not going to be anything like that and that'll never happen to me. And so once I kind of softened my heart and realized I need to, you know, find compassion, realize we're all capable of falling big time and we're all going to struggle and we're all going to mess up and disappoint each other and figure out how to make it up to each other. You know, that I guess helped me to think I can do that to other people. They're going to do it to me. And the truth is that I find so often when you are vulnerable, people are pretty awesome. Vulnerability brings out in most other people just such compassion and kindness. And we all think that we want to show our perfect side to other people, but I guess I just had this realization that showing that perfect, you know, perfectionist, everything's together side to other people, that actually people don't really like that. They don't connect to it. It makes them uncomfortable. But when you show your real vulnerable self to them, they suddenly relax themselves and they're like, oh, you know what? I have something like that too. I have a friend. We heard that so many times. It's just amazing how many people have gone through something like this. I have a friend, or I have a child too, who's gone through this. I know how you feel. And the truth is, instead of being judged, I got so much love and support. Aww. It was amazing. Aww.
So how's he doing now?
Really well. Really well. He's been out for close to a year and he's clean and he's finishing up his last year of high school right now, and has a job. He just got promoted to be a supervisor at work. So he's doing really well.
Oh, that's so great. And how's your little guy?
He's amazing. He is just an amazing little bundle of just intelligence and joy and sunshine. He's just like a ball of sunshine in our lives.
Oh, that's great. So backing up even further, you know, couldn't have been easy to jump into marriage and become a stepmom. Just tell us about what that was like for you.
That was really hard. It was really, really hard and different than I thought it was going to be. I was actually a child of divorced parents. And so I had step parents. I had a stepmom who my dad ended up divorcing in my teens. And that was a challenging relationship. And I have a stepfather who is amazing and one of my biggest supporters in my life. And so I thought, okay, I'm going to be great at this. You know, I have this example of what I don't want to do and what I do want to do. And I think I have the right philosophy of how to, you know, how to play a role in their life and be there for them, but really make sure my husband is still their main parent and he's the decision maker. And it just didn't go down that way at all. It was it was really hard. I came into their life at such a tough age. They were in middle school, which is such an awkward, hard time where, you know, it's just that for them being vulnerable and for being boys, you know, it was just really a lot of tough stuff. And so we worked through it, but we're still working through it. I mean, I know I read somewhere that it takes like 7 years for a step family to like get into their groove.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, oh, well, they're going to be almost out of the house by then. We're not ever going to get into our groove while they're still home. And it really is true. It just takes so much time and so much, I think, grace for ourselves and each other. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it's still a work in progress.
Well, what helped you during the most stressful times to stay together and not just fall apart? Not the family, but for you not to lose it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
When you have routines or strategies, or what helps you?
What helps me probably most, especially when you say not to lose it, is journaling.
Huh.
Really. I mean, I have to have a place where I can just let out all the craziness in my head and all of the, you know, judgment and fear. And then once I let it out, then I can go, okay, now what does my best self really want to say to this person? Or how do I really want to handle it? But I have to let that out, or it just builds up and kind of stews and gets all resentful and icky. So journaling is huge for me. I think being vulnerable, you know, like I said, the not keeping it inside, not trying to handle it ourselves. You know, I think at first when things were going badly with our son, we were like, we are going to handle it ourselves. And it was only when we opened up and got help from our family and from others that we really started getting somewhere with it. And so going to people and saying, we're struggling, this is how bad it is, and you know, what advice do you have? You know, kind of getting a consensus from people of saying, all right, well, 8 out of 10 people are all saying that this is what their sense of it is or what they would do in this situation. And just kind of trusting that wisdom and, you know, realizing that we could get really caught up in the details and really caught up in our fears. And so we would really have to reality check with people that we trusted. And, you know, I'm lucky that my parents are that for me. So they were a really big help in that time. But I think also just I'm a learner and a doer. And I think I have this part of me that's like, okay, here's a problem. What do I need to do? I'll read a million books. I'll read articles. I'll figure out, you know, I'll go and figure out whatever it is that you have to learn to get through this. And I really go and check with experts, and that comforts me actually. But it can then tend to lead to that part that wants to control and do too much and not let other people do the things they need to do. You know, that's a thing with the step parenting, is that it's really hard to know what my boundary should be versus my husband when it comes to the teenagers, and you know, what is my appropriate role versus his. And so I could go and do all this research, but if there was a part of it that he really needs to be the one to say this or convey this, to kind of allow him to do it and not try to control it and say, you got to say it this way. And that was a challenge for me.
Well, let's take a quick break for our sponsor. And then I want to come back and talk about how you mentioned all the great things, all the awesome things are on the other side of fear. How are you continuing to conquer fear today? So we'll come back to that right after this break. I really believe one of the most important things for being a vibrant and happy woman is eating right. I first experimented with clean eating about 5 or 6 years ago. By clean eating, I mean gluten-free, sugar-free, dairy-free, soy-free, just really concentrating on the clean things, whole foods, natural. Well, I discovered RX bars during that time, and they've been a part of my life ever since. They are my go-to snack when I need to grab and go, and it's perfect because then I don't have to run through the drive-thru when we're out and about. Well, now they have kids RX bars in 3 really good flavors that my kids love: apple cinnamon raisin, berry blast, and chocolate chip. This school year, I have stocked my entry closet with RX bars so that when the kids are leaving for the bus, someone will inevitably turn to me and say, "Mom, I forgot to eat breakfast." I love handing them an RX bar because there's no sugar and has 7 grams of protein and it's clean. I think this is the best thing I can give them to help them concentrate at school in the morning. I also have a couple of boxes in my van so that when we're driving around after school to piano and sports and everything else, I have something ready to go. You can get 25% off your first order of RX bars by going to rxbar.com/vibrantwomen and entering the coupon code vibrantwomen. Okay, welcome back, Gina. And as promised, I wanted to ask you, how do you continue to try to get to those awesome things that are on the other side of fear, even today? You know, your son is clean and things are looking brighter, but still, you know, life's a journey. So what other fears are you looking to overcome and how are you going about that?
I think right now, I wouldn't say I have like a specific fear that I'm trying to overcome, but I still just feel fear a lot and in general about all kinds of stuff. And so I think one of my tactics that's working really well is just sort of redefining that feeling that I get in my stomach. So it's fear. You know, I feel butterflies, I feel nauseous, I feel a little sick and you know, and I used to call that a sign, like that's a warning sign. It means run, don't do it. When you feel that sick feeling, it's a message that you're going down the wrong path. And instead, I decided to redefine that and say, oh, that's not a warning sign. That's just the feeling I'm always going to get when I do something new. When I do something.
I love that.
Yeah. Because I realized I can't avoid that feeling. And I hate that feeling. I mean, nobody likes it. But it's just like, oh, that's nervous feeling that you just. And so I think I get a lot out of when there's something that I can't avoid or I can't make it go away, I just flip it and call it something good. And that actually works for me. And so even like to speaking to you today and doing this interview, so I've got that nervous butterfly feeling right before we start and just saying, oh, that's just my feeling because I'm doing something new. And anytime I do something new, it's going to give me that feeling. It's not a warning sign. It's actually the opposite. It's a sign that I'm about to probably do something awesome because everything on the other side of fear is awesome.
Yeah.
And so, yeah.
Oh, that reminds me of, I heard that, I don't remember the name, but a singer decided to quit her career because she couldn't believe that after 3 years, she still got that sick feeling before every performance.
Yeah.
And then a coach was working with her and saying, guess what? I coach all kinds of musicians. Everyone gets that before a performance. And instead of saying it's a warning, like you said, or something wrong, just saying it's your energy rising to meet the occasion, just redefining it, like you said. So I love
exactly. That. Exactly. That's a perfect story. Yeah.
Well, so let's talk about a few of your favorite things. You mentioned you like to journal. What else do you do in the morning to make sure you're starting the day as your best self?
Getting up early, that is so huge for me. And it's really hard with a toddler. He wakes up anytime between 5 and 6. And so I really have to commit to setting my alarm for 4:30 or 5 if I want to have enough time.
Yeah.
But it just absolutely makes a difference in my day because I get up, I wake up really slowly. And so to wake up and just start being a mom right away is just, it's really hard. And if I can just have even a half hour, but ideally if I can have an hour, I'm just ready to go then. And so I have my coffee and I write in my journal, you know, I write what I'm grateful for. I think about what my priorities should be for the day. And it makes all the difference in the world ever since I've done it. And I thought of it at first, I'm sure like a lot of people would, like, what a loss. How am I going to, I'm going to have to go to bed so early. And now it's been, I've probably been doing it for 6 months and it just feels wonderful. I do go to bed really early, sometimes at like 8 o'clock, but I just love that time so much and I wouldn't give it up for anything.
It's really great. And so what does your husband think of your early bedtime, early wake up time?
Well, you know, it kind of fits perfectly. We have our own unique little life with having a toddler and teenagers at the same time. And so I'm sure you know this, that teenagers sometimes suddenly get the urge to start talking at like 11 p.m. And that's yes. when they finally are like going to open up about that thing you've been trying to talk to them about or something. Yeah. And so it works out well because my husband kind of gets to have the nights for the boys. Uh-huh. And, you know, so he does go to bed later and then I wake up and try to let him sleep in the mornings. Perfect. And so it really works well in our unique situation that he kind of gets to have that one-on-one time with the boys if they need him.
And I love how you've decided not to compare or not to take everyone else's wisdom. You know, I've heard advice that you should always go to bed together. Well, that's just silly. And yeah. Creating your own bubble of happiness is beautiful.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a really good example of that, that I think realizing that there is not one right answer to do anything pretty much, especially with relationships. It depends on the two or whatever number of people involved. And yeah, this works really well for us. And we get our alone time. We both get to work from home for part of the week. And so we get our alone time during the day and use that to connect. Yeah.
Well, what's your favorite easy meal, Gina?
My favorite easy meal is, so we just got an air fryer and I love it so much. And one of my all-time favorite indulgences in life are French fries. I can't resist them. And so this is a way to have healthier French fries where you can make them with little or no oil and then the air just heats it up and makes them super crispy, which I love. So my meal, which the whole meal takes 20 minutes, if that, is a burger bowl. So I make my crunchy French fries or sweet potato fries in the air fryer, and then we top it with ground beef and fried onions or fried mushrooms, or then whatever you would want to put on a burger, pickles, you know, lettuce, tomato, ketchup, you know, mustard, all that good stuff. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we'll put like a fried egg on top of it. It's so good.
Oh.
It's amazing.
So you make the fries just from a potato and then put them in the air fryer? And how long do they have to be in there?
They take about 15 minutes or so. Depends how thick you cut them. But yeah, about 15, 20 minutes. And then so while those are cooking in the air fryer, we, you know, cook up the ground beef and chop up some pickles and lettuce and tomato. And it's just all ready to put together. And then we just do a bed of the fries and top everything else on top and eat it with a fork.
Yum. Oh, that sounds
great. Really good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the kids like it too.
Yeah.
Well, everyone, you can find a link to Gina's air fryer on our show notes page at jenriday.com/105. And Gina, what's your favorite way to relax or boost your mood or both?
Relaxing. I'm a big time introvert. And so to me, relaxing is alone time. And I can be happy doing a lot of different things. I'm really lucky that my husband is so wonderful. And if I tell him I need a little time, he'll, you know, take our toddler and go do something and give me some time. And I mean, if I'm writing in my journal or just reading or even just organizing by myself, I just really get recharged from that.
Cool. And what about waking up on the wrong side of the bed and you have to boost your mood fast? Any strategies?
Yeah. Yeah. I do those power poses from that Amy Cuddy TED Talk.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Totally. Wonder Woman pose.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah, I do it. And I'll do it for like 2 minutes and it seriously changes my mood. Or I'll do it sometimes in the shower. And yeah, I just feel it just, I raise my chin and just make myself smile and I just feel better.
So did you hear the Jill Payne interview on Vibrant Women?
Yeah.
When she talked about that. Yeah.
Yes.
Those who don't know what we're talking about, it's episode 91, jenriday.com/91. I'll put a link to that in the show notes. But yeah, I do it too. It's the fastest way. And exercise sometimes takes a few more minutes. But yeah, just pulling that shoulders back, chest out, chin up. It's pretty powerful for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I'm starting to teach my kids and it's getting hilarious. We're all walking around like we're superheroes. Oh, funny. What's your favorite book, Gina?
My favorite book, so I love Brene Brown, and I would say my favorite book is The Power of Vulnerability, and I'm pretty sure that that's just an audiobook. I don't think that's an actual book of hers. It's a taping of a workshop she did, I think, and it's really amazing. But I'm currently reading her book, Rising Strong, and it's pretty awesome. It's kind of blowing me away. I can't quite say that it's going to top The Power of Vulnerability yet because I haven't finished it, but it's really making me think about some things that I've never thought about before.
Ooh, I love books like that.
Yeah.
And I happen to know you heard about a workshop and so you jumped on a plane to go visit and see Brene Brown's workshop in North Carolina. So you are a diehard fan.
I am. Yeah, I really am. She is, if you're relating to some of the stuff I'm saying about perfectionism and stuff, I just think you would relate to her too, because I relate to her so much. Just, I know she's also a firstborn. I know she struggles with perfectionism. I know that when she's afraid, she'll jump right into controlling and blaming. And so listening to her speak is just like, it's like she's this, I don't know, the good angel on my shoulder who knows exactly how to say what I need to hear, like me specifically, about how to get through the fog of whatever I'm going through. And yeah, she's changed my life. Yeah.
I love her too. Yeah. Well, what does it mean to be a vibrant, happy woman?
For me, being a vibrant, happy woman, I think it really involves slowing way down. And I just have learned that in the last couple of years, especially, that when I try so hard to chase after, you know, people pleasing or perfectionism, I just get so frazzled. And so when I just slow way down and just look at what's right in front of me, I'm able to really see clearly what the right thing is to do and to do it. And so I think it helps me to be a better mom. It helps me to be a better wife. And it helps me to live in the moment, which I know we all hear that all the time, like living in the moment and being in the present moment. And that's how I get myself to do it, is to just slow down and stop rushing and trying so hard all the time. And I think also simplifying has really made a huge difference in making me have a vibrant, happy life. I'm really into minimalism. I love the minimalist podcasts and have really bought into that whole idea of how we're so distracted by all of the stuff and all the clutter in our lives all the time. And when I really, in the last year also, my husband and I have cleared out tons of clutter in our house and really simplified our stuff. And it has made us so much happier. There's so much less to do and take care of all the time. I got rid of like 75% of my clothes. So I just wear like the same few outfits every week. And it's my favorite stuff. And I love what I have, but I don't have a lot. And it's just, everything is so much easier. So,
I love that.
Those two things, you know, slowing down, simplifying. And then, I think accepting that fear and struggle are just part of the journey. And they're not something to be avoided, that I, you know, embracing them.
Yeah.
I really find happiness when I do that.
Yeah. Embrace them and find out what's on the other side of that fear.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, let's have a challenge to our listeners and maybe tell us where you see yourself heading in the future, just so we can imagine you there. And then we'll say goodbye.
Well, the challenge I'm going to give is something that I just heard yesterday. I say heard because I do almost everything on audiobooks in Rising Strong with Brené Brown. She was talking about, so my challenge to everybody is think about someone who is really a stressful person in your life, someone you really struggle with. You're having such a hard time figuring out what to do or dealing with this problem that they're, you know, bringing. And what if you were told with absolute certainty and you knew for sure that they are actually doing the best they can, then how would that change the way you see them? And to me, that just really, really opened my mind in a new way of saying, okay, if somebody who I'm struggling with is really doing the best they can, they don't have the tools to do any better right now. What would I do? Well, I would drop my anger. That's just a waste of time. That's not going to motivate somebody to be better when they can't do any better right now. And I would either help them or I would set a boundary and say, okay, this, you know, something's not going to work here. And so I just found a lot of freedom in that. And I would love to, I had my husband do that exercise yesterday too, and it was just really interesting. So
how do you do the exercise? You just decide to imagine that they're doing the best they can and then decide whether to help or set a boundary?
Yeah, right. And so you just imagine this person. And, you know, I think it's natural to, at first, people are going to say, well, they're not doing the best they can. I know they're not. And to say, okay, but let that go. What if like God came down and told you, I promise they're doing the best they can. I guarantee it. And you really believed it. It's about, how does that change you? How does it change how you feel inside and how you would move forward? Yeah. Because I think we all spend so much time hoping someone is just about to change, or how can I motivate them, or how do I need to push them? And instead to say, what if you just accepted they're doing the best they can? And maybe the best they can isn't good enough for you. Maybe you're going to have to say, then this isn't going to work or something. But you might instead say, okay, I'm going to stop putting them in a situation where they keep failing. I'm going to help them. I'm going to accept that I need to take more responsibility, or I'm going to let go of some expectations or something. And I just think, there's a lot of freedom in that.
Yeah, I immediately thought of a couple of people and I tried, but immediately when I went there and I thought, okay, they're doing the best they can, my stomach sank and I felt sad for them, but also a lot of compassion.
So, yes.
Well, it's a good exercise. I'm going to have to do some more after we get off the interview. Well, Gina, my goodness, this has been amazing. I know everyone's going to be wanting more of you, and I don't know. So that's why I want to ask you, do you have any big plans for the future? Can you write a book for us? Is really what I want.
I don't know. Maybe if you help me.
Well, mine isn't even done. So
I don't know. I don't have any plans right now. I don't know what my future holds. I know I'm happier than I've ever been. And I'm just starting to really play with this in the last year of feeling that fear and doing it anyway and going forward and just not having it have to have a bigger plan that I know right now. I'm just going step by step. So I don't know. Yeah, maybe I would write a book. Maybe I would teach a class or something. I am so passionate about this child development and passionate about minimalism and passionate about so much of what you do with Vibrant Happy Women. I feel like it's all connected. And I think about that a lot of like, how could I write or do something to show how all of this is connected and sending the same message of, you know, keep it simple and see the best. And, you know, it's all the little steps that add up to a happy life and all of that stuff. So I don't know.
Well, you have big things. You've touched my heart today for sure. So thank you for being you, for being so authentic and vulnerable and having no agenda, just being Gina. It was beautiful. Thank you for being on the show.
Thank you, Jen.
That episode is full of so many nuggets of wisdom from Gina, and you can find several of those quotes, which were so good, along with Gina's recipe, her favorite books, and everything else we talked about on our show notes page at jenriday.com/105. Also, don't forget to enter to win one of those $100 Amazon gift cards celebrating 100 episodes of Vibrant Happy Women. You can enter to win at jenriday.com/giveaway. Join me next time for a happy bit featuring the mom's ultimate spring break checklist, the perfect guide to help you have a more enjoyable spring. Even if your spring break is over, you're going to love this checklist because it will give you some great ideas to keep your kids entertained this spring. Also, we'll be announcing the winners for that giveaway, so don't miss it. I will see you next time. Until then, take care.
Thanks for listening to the Vibrant Happy Women podcast at www.jenriday.com.